的话是由临床台医师来报告 split buccal fat wrap in modified fellow palatoplasty surgical in technique and early result. 林医师请。
Good morning, I'm fourth year resident 林崇凯 and the article I'm presenting today.
声音，崇凯声音可能要再大一点。
OK, 这样子可以吗？
OK.
OK.The article I'm presenting today is about using a split buccal fat flap in modified fellow palatoplasty. And this article is written by our previous fellow Rafael and Professor Low. 下一张。Okay. And the oral nasal fistula after palatoplasty is an early indicator of negative results, and the risks are even greater among patients with wide clefs.Doing a lateral relaxing incision were invented to release the tension during closure of the mucoperiosteal flaps and to reduce the possibility of transverse maxillary collapse during growth. Interpositional buccal fat flaps could also promote healing of the palatal flaps to fill the dead space between the oral flap and the nasal flap and also achieve reduction of possible palatal contraction. And there are alsosome pedicled buccal fat flaps proposed to cover the bone surface and prevent secondary healing. And however, these procedures were all isolated procedures without any description of combining benefits in a single procedure. And this article is to describe the surgical technique and the early results of utilizing a split buccal fat flaps in modified furlough palatoplasty.This study includes consecutive non-syndromic patients with cleft palate doing a modified double opposing Z-plasty plus split buccal fat flaps. And physical examination is done at 1, 2, and 4 weeks post-op and 3 months, 6 months, and 12 months after surgery. Speech assessment related data were also collected.Doing a modified palatoplasty includes hard palate mucoperiosteal flaps and doing a dissection of a pyramidal space, a clinical judgment of flap mobilization into the midline, and doing a double opposing Z-plasty with small limbs. And this is the supplementary figure from this article. In the figure of the left, you see the anterior nasal layer was repaired using the Vollmer turnover flap.In the figure on the right, the figure explains the modified furlough palatoplasty, and which is to transpose the left mucosa flap anteriorly and the right musculomucosal flap posteriorly. And this figure shows the surgical repair of a Vole type 3 cleft palate with a defect in the nasal lining at the junction of this hard and soft palate.And the split buccal fat flap is needed at either the Z-plasty flaps showed insecurity during the flap transposition, or the flaps were under tension during closure, or there is any incomplete closure of the nasal layer at the hard to soft palate junction. And after that, any defect in the nasal layer at the junctionof the hard and soft palates was covered with posterior portions of the split buccal fat flaps, and which is sutured just posterior to the hard palate and anterior to the transposed muscle. In this figure, you see the buccal fat was harvested using a gentle pull with forceps after cutting the buccinator, and the flap was split with full preservation of an intact and single wide base once a sufficient flap length was obtained. At the figure above, you see the left buccal fat flap was raised from the lateral palate incision, which is just posterior to the maxillary tuberosity. And then the flap was gently retracted to confirm the adequate length, and that is, and to cross the midline at the junction of the soft and hard palates and to reach the anterior maxillary dental arch region. And on the figure below, it shows that the split buccal fat flap with its posterior portion tunneled submucosally behind the greater palatine neurovascular bundle to the palatal repair site with an implanting with an incomplete closure of nasal layer. And this video is to show the procedures of the split buccal fat flap. And to open the buccal inner muscle, and then with a gentle pull, slowly to pull the buccal fat flap, and to measure its adequate length. And the authors emphasize that the manipulation of the split buccal fat flap has to be very meticulous because the pedicle of the flap is pretty fragile. And then the posterior portion of the flap was tunneled through the behind the greater palatine neurovascular bundle. And then after that, the posterior portions of the split buccal fat flap were sutured to the nasal lining and covering the junction of the soft and hard palates. And putting a fat tissue in the anterior soft palate region after doing a posterior muscle transposition could not only prevent the oral nasal fistula and reduce the local fibrosis, but also fill that space created by the posterior transposition of the muscles. And the oral side of the repair was then completed by transposing the right mucosal flap anteriorly and the left musculomucosal flap posteriorly. The anterior buccal fat flaps were finally covered, the lateral relaxed incisions by using hammock sutures. And this video shows the rest of the part of the procedure. Okay, and the results. And the results were that 56 patients underwent modified frontopalatoplasty plus a split buccal fat flaps were collected. And harvest, split, and placement of the flap took 12 minutes per flap, and no patients developed postoperative complications, and 78.9% of patients were diagnosed with normal resonance after surgery. And the buccal fat pad flaps has been proposed by several studies before, with only an about an extra 15 minutes of operation time and minimal facial aesthetic impact of facial symmetry in the donor site region. And in the study, split buccal fat flaps were adopted to decrease the risk of postoperative fistula formation and palatal contraction, and to reduce bone exposure during the healing process, and to restore a mechanism for speech production. And the muscles were repaired by doing several small double opposing Z plasty with an overlapped transverse lateral belly pandatini sling. And the buccal fat flaps were harvested from the lateral relaxing incision without adding another donor site. And the buccal fat flap has a delicate vascular supply, which means that the author emphasized that when you're manipulating the buccal fat flap, you has to be careful. And the vascular integrity of the described split buccal fat flap could be one of the target of the future investigation, which is to investigate the vascularization, and could also distinguish the difference of the term of the pedicled buccal fat flap versus the pedicled buccal fat graft. And this study shows good 12-month healing status of the palatal incisions with no wound separation of fistula. And the early results showed that palatal length appears to be maintained following double opposing Z-plasty palatoplasty plus the buccal fat flaps. However, there is no long-term investigation in the study of the transverse maxillary development and speech outcome. And many pediatric patients with clefts wider than 15 millimeter were referred late beyond the age span in the cleft protocol. And in these cases, a palatoplasty has to be performed before cleft lip repair to avoid further delay in speech development. And in this supplementary figure, the authors want to show the intraoral views of the 17-month-old baby, which is the above row and the center row, and then 18-month-old children with which is the row below, with unrepaired unilateral complete cleft lip and palate, with low socioeconomical status and lives far away from the medical center. And they received modified frontopalatoplasty with a split buccal fat flap before lip repair, and presented mucosalization of a lateral recipient regions at 1 week and 4 week postoperatively. And the future investigations, for the future directions, the authors would like to know the functional outcomes, including velopharyngeal function and resonance of less experienced surgeons doing a modified furlough Z-plasty. And a reported VPI rate was 5.5% by Professor Lowe in 2016. And the authors would also like to know the prophylactic purpose of doing a split buccal fat flaps compared with other approaches using autogenous tissues or synthetic biomaterials for prevention of a postoperative palatal fistula and scar contraction. So the conclusion of the study is that combining the modified furlough palatoplasty as well as a split buccal fat flaps could provide adequate cleft palate closure with a rapid mucosalization of lateral relaxed incisions without any fistula formation. And other surgeons could consider adding this technical innovation to their surgical procedures, as it will provide additional security using a layer of autogenous tissue for raw surface coverage and reinforcement of the palatal flaps. Okay, thank you.
林医师结束了，好，喂，林医师，冯凯，是结束了，哦，好，那我们请，请问大家有没有什么问题或者是 comment？ 部长有没有要追加的？好，我想这边。
文章的其实一个重点就是说，我们在做palate repair， 一个很重要的技术就是不要让它有破洞，就是有 fissure。那因为特别是在vol 3 跟 vol 4 这个 crack， 就是单侧跟双侧的重叠，在 repair 的时候，在 nasal side 在 junction 的地方 nasal side 有时候会太紧。 有时候 repair 很 weak， 甚至没有办法完全 repair， 就像这个破口一样。那当然，你如果 adequate tension release， 在 oral side 就可以补得很完全。主要 oral side 是一个主要的预防 fissure 的 repair， 所以你 oral side 如果 tension release 好的话，理论上是不会出现。 这个oral nasal fissure， 那所以当然如果有一个 buccal flap 在那边保护它的 nasal side 的话会更好。那另外一个重点就是说，在我们在做 furlough 的时候，常常因为 muscle 要往后推，所以在接近 junction， 也就是说 soft palate 的前端。 常常会出现一个 dead space， 然后就是 nasal side、 oral side 就有一个 dead space 在那边。那 dead space 当然就会产生一些 healing fibrosis， 所以如果有 buccal fat 在那边保护的话，所以这两重作用也可以减少它的 fibrosis。所以这个就当然让它的 healing 更 smooth， 让可以避免它的fissure， 因为 这个其实都是让他的 hard palate， 这 palate repair 可以更顺利，将来有更好的 speech， 跟减少他产生对 local 的所谓的dental alveolar arch 的影响嘛，所以这个 idea 其实是双重的保护了。那 我的 practice 到现在还是保护lateral raw surface， 因为我的 flap release 相当的不错，所以我其实不太需要这个 buccal fat 来保护这个nasal side。 不过这个东西多一层保护，其实就像他讲的，对比较没有经验的初学者医师，这是一个相当好的一个保护的效果，让他比较心安了。 所以当然最近 PIS 还会有一边我们这个 group 的 buccal fat 的 paper 出来，就是讲说长期久睡的影响，那个整个 dental alveolar arch 会比没有用 buccal fat 会更好。这是以上临床上对 buccal fat 的应用，谢谢。谢谢林医师，我可不可以
comment？
可以。第一个，我要恭喜一下罗主任这个方面，第一个。
有很好的 paper 可以 demonstrate technique。第二个是，确实这个 technique 真的可以帮助这些比较没有经验的医师，如果破洞的话，要怎么样 salvage。那现在这个 technique 似乎不难，但是帮助很大。那最后一样是刚才你提到说，九月份，九个月，九岁的人说的那个 dental alveolar arch 的人很好。那我相信我们再 follow up 再久一点的话，看。 Mesial bone 的 growth 到看需要到做 OGS 的机会可能会减少，因为理论上来讲，有这些 tissue coverage 没有 scar 没有 ONF， 这个在各方面来讲都是帮助非常大，尤其是去做义诊啊，像上次 Fayette 说有一个 fistula 的 textbook 要讲的那么高的 fistula rate， 我想这个对小孩子来讲是一个很大的 disaster， 所以呢，要强调说在 primary surgery 可以用任何的方法，可以不要有 fistula 的话，事实上后面的speech 和 facial development 都会帮助非常非常多。那这方面，我想也可以再继续引导大家往这方面走。那么 可见的未来，可能在五年、十年，你这些病人都长到了15岁的时候，你另外一篇 paper 可以出来看这个，可以看 maxillofacial development 怎么样？恭喜恭喜，这非常好。谢谢诸位的
comment。我本身倒是有一个想法，就是说这些 fat pad 里面是不是也有一些 stem cell？那这些 fat pad 里面的 stem cell 如果 在 soft palate 里面，那旁边的话有一些 muscle，那之后这些 fat 的发展会是怎么样？会是维持一直都是 fat 呢？或者是它受到这个 muscle 的刺激，或者是有一些神经长进来之后，它有机会变成 muscle 呢？或许 MRI 的 study 可以给我们一些 建议，这个将来在其实可能周医师可以帮忙回答，或者说我们因为周医师那篇九岁的对
dental alveolar arch 的影响，我们在看影像的时候其实也没注意到特别那个 fat 跑去哪里了。我们临床的观察是，我在做 lateral relaxing incision 的buccal fat 的保护。 常常在三个礼拜，那个 fat 就消失了，那个 mucosalization 就长好了，那个 scar tissue 很小，甚至以后的牙齿也不会挤在一起，dental clouding 的这些现象出来。那仔细去看它的组织，在那个附近，我不晓得周医师有没有观察到，在 CT 上，因为我们是用 CT 去看的了，那。 我个人在临床上是没有特别，所以那个到底出现什么？我的意思说在 lateral relaxation incision 呢？至于您主任问的在跟muscle 的关系，这个我也不知道，这也是需要久一点的观察才知道。跟老师报告，还有主任报告，其实。
我们在9个月使用 buccal fat pad 来做 lateral raw surface 的 covering， 其实主要是跟之前我们用 surgery seal 哦，那之后可能如果有可以的话，可以跟那个现在那个 sponge 去做比较。那我们的比较族群主要还是跟 surgery seal 来做比较了。那 buccal fat pad 在 ABG 前的 CBCT 看起来其实时间也很久了，所以也看不到那边有额外的 extra 的 soft tissue 的增加。 但我们从它的 tension， 比如说它 scarring 的状况，我们从 2D 或者说从那些整个 formation palate， 它有没有受到一开始 immediately 术后的 tension 或者是 raw surface 直接面对到 exposure 的话，来侦测九岁时候的它那个 palate formation morphology 的 change， 其实 fat 的这种字体的一个 graft 是有比较好的，比较不会去 restriction 它整个 palate 的 growth。那你说要来侦测它的 fat 到底跑去哪里？可能要再更近一点的，或者是说，因为他这九年来其实也有蛮多的人生的一些历练在，所以应该很难知道说他的状况会怎么样去生长。是的，好，谢谢邦云哥哥的
comment。那请问？ 其他医师还没有什么问题？如果没有的话，我们就进入下一个 topic， 由林安柔医师讲 The Impact on Nasal Septal Anatomy and Physiology Following the Full One Osteotomy for Osteonexis Surgery。 林医师请。这样有听到吗？
有事，你帮我看一下。有。好。我要关全屏幕。有。好，开始。那没有全屏幕的。 可能不会那么快。
上次是没有全萤幕。
现在没有。
有了有了。
Hey, good morning, everyone. I'm a fourth year resident Lin Anrong. And today I'm going to present this paper, The Impact on Nasal Septal Anatomy and Physiology Following LeFort I Osteotomy for Orthogonic Surgery. And this was from the Journal of Craniofacial Surgery published in last year.哎，有听到我的声音吗？
有听到。
好，谢谢。Okay, I'll continue. The LeFort I osteotomy during OGS will mobilize the maxilla and correct dental facial abnormalities. However, it has the potential to impact nasal airway form and function. Specifically, the septal osteotomy separates the native.Attachment of the vomer and quadrangular cartilage from the underlying nasal spine and palatine bone. So changes in the anterior posterior location of the maxilla, as well as the rotational translation to the upper mid face, all have the potential to cause adverse physiologic sequela for the nasal septum and airway.However, to date, no study has utilized the assessment of radiographic to determine change in the septal position and the subjective quality of life evaluation for LeFort I osteotomy for OGS surgery. So the aim of this study is to characterize the changes in radiographic in the nasal septum and correlate these changes to a subjective assessment of patient's ability to breathe through the nose. So this was a retrospective study, and the patients who underwent OGS by LeFort I osteotomy from this tertiary center's oral maxillofacial surgery department during the 2013 to 2018 were enrolled.And the LeFort I osteotomy include one piece and segmental osteotomies. And the nasal airway was assessed using CT scans, which combined CT preoperatively and postoperatively CT at least 8 weeks after the operation. And the septal osteotomy was performed by a double guarded osteotome to divide the inferior portion of the septum from the nasal crest of the maxilla. And the CT scans were analyzed using synapse viewer by Fujifilm. And the angles were calculated by trigonometry functions in the Excel.And first, they would determine if a septal perforation was performed. And then a single septal deviation in the axial plane was measured at the largest point of the deviation. And in coronary view, they measured the deviation at four locations. As the picture shown, number one is halfway between the nasal tip and piriform aperture. And number two is the piriform aperture. And the number three is halfway between the piriform aperture and the corona.And the number four is the coronal location. And both degree and millimeter were measured. As the secondary outcomes, inferior meatal windows on the lateral nasal side walls and the largest dimensions of the nasal swell body and inferior turbinates were also measured. And the prevalence of septal perforation was calculated.And the cross-section area of perforation was measured by the radius of the minor and major axils multiplied by the pi. The chronic sinusitis survey was used to evaluate the changes in patients' nasal breathing and sinus symptoms. Among them, the question 1C was recorded separately. It asked the patients to rate their nasal congestion and difficulty breathing through the nose.And a total of 38 patients were enrolled. 8 were excluded due to lack of the pre-op CT. And the surgery were performed by 7 surgeons. All patients show changes of the nasal septum deviation at one of the 4 points in coronal plan. Statistically significant differences of the linear displacement were noted at number 1, number 2, and number 4 locations, and angular displacements at number 1 location. The maximal septal deviations in the axial plan was up to 24 degrees and 13.8 millimeters. And the mean diameter of septal swell increased significantly from 11.3 millimeter to 12.1 millimeter. And the prevalence of the septal perforation was 20%. All occurred in the mid to posterior aspect of the septum. And the cross-section size of perforation ranged from 35.6 to 163.1 millimeter square. And from the chronic sinusitis survey, we can see that 70% of the patient showed a worsened score with regard to difficulty breathing. Only 2 and 7 patients demonstrated improved and stable nasal breathing respectively. And the mean scale changed from 1.4 to 3.0, representing more than 2-fold worsening of the nasal obstruction. Also, the mean score of this survey increased from 70.7 to 15.6, and 90% of the patient has significant worsening severity. In the discussion, the author mentioned several factors related to nasal obstruction. First is the internal nasal valve. It is the narrowest portion of the nasal airway, and any abnormalities to these intrinsic structures can cause obstruction. And secondly is the nasal septum deviation. The nasal septum is the main structure support for the nasal dorsum, and also the most medial aspect of the internal valve. As a result, nasal septal deviation also play a critical role in nasal obstruction symptoms. And this ultimately increases nasal resistance, sleep disorder breathing, and snoring. Except for the cartilage and bony septums, additional factors mentioned by author include the mucosa of the septum, turbinates of the lateral nasal sidewall, and increases in the mucosa or vascular sinusoid can also impinge the airflow. And another possible factor mentioned by the author is the compensatory hypertrophy of the nasal mucosa. Usually the septal deviation will associated with the contralateral increase of the turbinate and compensatory increase of the septal swell body. However, the mechanism was not fully understood. And also, septal perforation is another factor. It can lead to the loss of septal continuity and cause turbulent airflow. It will waste away the moisture and ultimately result in secondary obstruction and discomfort. Additional symptoms of a septal perforation include airflow allocations, loss of airflow warming, bothersome audible whistling. And the treatment is challenging and may include moisturizing techniques, silicone spacer, or surgical reconstruction. Although this study was unable to identify the etiologies for nasal septum deviation or perforation, the author addressed several hypotheses. The simplest one is the iatrogenic surgical trauma and inadequate healing. And second hypothesis is that the degree of the maxillary impaction may contribute to septal compression and subsequent deviation. Moreover, it is possible that maxillary disimpaction places tensile forces on the nasal mucosa and the perichondrium during the healing phase, and which may lead to further impaired healing. Several limitations for this study are mentioned, including the retrospective nature, and it is from a single tertiary site, And also they lack the anterior rhinoscopy or nasal endoscope or rhinomanometry. From this study, the author concluded that the LeFort I osteotomy in orthogonic surgery resulted in changes to the septal angle in all patients, and subjective nasal dyspnea was reported in 90% of the patients. And the impact on nasal breathing can potentially be credited to the associated change in flow through the narrow internal nasal valve, so body diameter increase and concomitant inferior turbinate changes. And further understanding of the anatomic change and nasal airway obstruction after such operation were warranted to improve surgical technique and post-operative outcomes. Thank you.
Oh, 谢谢林医师的报告。 请问大家有没有什么问题？
我可不可以问一下？
哦，朱维行。
一个，我看看这个是哪一个 center 出来的？ 你再看一次好吗？
等一下哦，它是一个英国的，这边可能没有写，它是一个英国的
paper，
对，叫做那个这叫什么？就 Portsmouth， 就是 Portsmouth
啊 ，Portsmouth，
哦，第二个是。
他才这么多个 patients， 竟然有 seven surgeons 开这么多病人，所以他等于是很多个 surgeon 不同开法。啊，第三个，我觉得他的重视是好，但他的 septal fistula rate 太高了，他有六个病人是有 fistula，那这个在我们 technique 是。 我至少我的经验里面，我们的 septal fistula 的机会没有。最后一个是 surgical technique， 用那个两个 blunt 的那个音叉去敲的，在理论上来讲，那个是一个 blind surgery， 理论上我会觉得还是用我们的方法把 mucosa 都剥好以后，把 septum 剥开拿掉，大概就可以 prevent 他所说的那些问题。 尤其是他们的病人大概大部分都是得4万之一，upward impaction 比较多，所以产生的 inflammation 机会就大。你 septum 泵如果全都拿干净之后，往上 impaction 时候产生的 septal deviation 就会很少。周医师可能我们以后来做 study 一下，针对相对的 paper 可以来做一些 study， 说我们的 septum 的 deviation 到底有多少？那因为我。 可以先在开刀前先看一下，说 septum 都正的人，开刀后有没有歪掉？第二个 septum 歪的人，我们都有 routine 的，都把那个歪的地方，你上次说了，septal swelling 那个部分的泵，我们大部分都 release 掉。这样之后，我们产生的结果怎么样？哎，这个倒是蛮好的 innovation， 包括我们的 patient 用我们 technique 来讲一下，对于 septum 本身的 fracture。 本身并不一定要用那个硬插，那硬插是一个 blind surgery，mucosa 会破掉的机会很大，所以你把 mucosa 保护好以后，再把 septum 拿掉以后，事实上我们 mucosa 破掉的机会不多，而且很少。如果你做的好的话，所以这些 technical innovation 事实上应该可以再 repeat 把它弄出去，因为oral surgery 本身的 development 的过程和我们 craniofacial 的 plastic surgery 做的方法不太一样，那 ENT 所 focus 的那个 septal 的 surgery。 和我们做的真正的 LeFort 我们这样播的方式也不太一样，所以这些我们可以来把这 technical innovation 也好，说 improvement 也好，再加上我们的 follow up，我们的 follow up 来讲，我们 septal deviation 开刀前我们有没有注意到？注意到我们有什么 correct？ 开刀前如果说都没有而产生 angulation， 那么这份我们怎么预防？我想这是蛮好的一个 paper 我们可以做的。我相信我们的结果都比他们好的太多了，因为不可能有一个非常 preparation rate 那么高。
可以病人可以接受，很不容易。谢谢。我可以问问题吗？哦，请。对啊，我是蛮惊讶看到 septal perforation 有20%的机会的哈，似乎是相当高。因为临床上我其实没有观察到病人有 complain 说。 他有没有 nasal turbulence， 呼吸上有没有什么怪怪的地方。所以就像诸位指示的，我们其实在这一块其实是可以很详细的去再探讨一下。那因为我们术后其实都有很好的CBCT 的 documentation 嘛，因为像这个研究它的 CBCT 有时候还是什么两个月以后，其实甚至不到六个月，像这个似乎还时间还不够久。其实我最想要观察的就是唇腭裂的病人、啊、因为唇腭裂的病人几乎百分之百都是 septal deviation， 那开完刀以后deviation 有没有变好，这个其实也是我们可以看，搞不好开完刀以后 deviation 会变好也不一定。 perforation 有没有，因为我们唇腭裂的病人要拨 nasal floor 的时候常常都拨不干净，常常会破掉又常常不好补了。其实我在想可能卢医师张医师在这一块上其实是一个很好的研究题目了，就是唇腭裂病人的 OGS 他的 septum 的变化真的是不错，可以值得研究。手术前很多病人都 complain 鼻塞嘛，那手术有没有什么改变，这个其实是一个很好的题目。
一般来就是在做的时候其实 nasal floor 跟 nasal septum 的地方、哦、其实是两个不同的区块。那 nasal floor 来讲的话，在唇腭裂的患者因为他们的 nasal floor 是补过的，所以在跟 oral side 的 mucosa 要 separation 的时候的确是会可能 routine 里都会有一些laceration。 那不过这个 septum 的地方的话可能就是也不懂他的 methodology， 就是国外这一篇他们的 methodology 到底是怎么样 separation 的，会造成这么多的septum 的 perforation。 因为 septum 的 perforation 的话理论上应该是两侧的 mucosa 都有破的时候它才有机会产生一个 perforation， direct perforation。 那这些 perforation 的话的确是会影响到整个 nasal flow。 nasal flow 在比较理想的状况是 septum 整个都是直的，然后它 turbinate 跟 septum 之间有一定的距离，那它会形成一个 lamina flow。 那如果是单侧有一个 deviation 或者是有一个 compensatory 的 hypertrophy of turbinate， 那基本上他们的nasal flow 那边的 nasal flow 就会很 significant 的reduction。 那其实也都可以送患者去做 nasal resistant 的测试。那在鼻喉科的话，不过现在因为疫情的关系他们是都停下来， 这部分是都没有在提供服务的。那请问大家有没有对于这个方面有没有另外的想法？我另外有想到就是一个因为我们做比较多的 posterior impaction， posterior impaction 的话理论上也是会对 posterior 的 nasal airway 有一些 reduction， 但是通常这个 turbinate 它在塞的点通常是最前面，因为最前面这个地方它如果有 nasal allergy， 它是鼻孔一进去最先接触到过敏源，所以通常是前面会比后面塞啦。那所以在结构上面通常如果注意去看的话，其实它 posterior impaction 对于整体的 resistance 影响应该是不会太大。那导致前面如果是有一些患者他是 by max protrusion 或者 maxillary excessive 的话，这样子他做 anterior impaction 比较会影响到整体的nasal resistance， 特别是他提到的 nasal valve 的部分也是在前面的部位。所以就是 impaction 其实也有 clockwise 跟 counterclockwise rotation， 相信 这部分是会有不一样的。
我可以建议一下几个 technique 上的第一个impaction 的时候 ，posterior impaction 就像林医师讲一样，大概不必太考虑到 airway 的问题，因为 turbinate 在前面。在 anterior impression 往上 impression， 尤其在做 segmental impression 的时候，大家注意到我都一定把 nasal flow 都磨掉。你 impression 二 mm， 我就把 nasal flow 磨掉两 mm。第一个 septum 一定要磨掉，这样的话就预防它 septal deviation。第二个，你要预防它的 L 位的问题。你 impact 两 mm 的时候，你 L 那个 nasal flow 跟 MT 的 rim 也要把它磨掉几 mm， 这样的话它的 L 位的空间就会好得多。所以大家记得这个原则，你往上列的时候 L 位一定要 narrow 的时候，你尽可能把可以的安全范围内，你把 nasal flow 跟piriform 的 margin 的地方，你都把它磨一些掉，磨一些掉的话，这样子的话相对之下，nasal deviation 的机会少了， airway 也不会影响太大。这个也可以 report， 周医师你再提一下， 把这方面的我们的那个nasal flow 的那个 burning 的那个 technique， 事实上我们可以把它发表出去写一下都没关系。这个倒是很好的一个大家给大家去注意到说 nasal flow 磨掉，磨到了基本把全部磨掉到 mucosa， blood supply 还不会被影响，因为 blood supply 不会影响到，所以你泵磨掉是没关系。但是对 airway 来讲，你可以 prevent 它的那个刚才说的 turbinate。 当然 the other way 是在做 turbinate surgery， 这又要到牵涉到另外一个 surgery 或者是 ENT。 我想上次我们做了几个，觉得还是 combination 不一定那么好，但是磨泵比较简单对我来讲。
我这边想有个问题，就是治疗旋风，就是说，还是想请问主委啊，就是说，因为我记得我们之前有个 redo 的 case 是中国来的嘛，那时候我们是因为刚刚主委提的是关于，就是说有时候 impression 的时候，你还是要担心这个会 septal deviation， 所以我们在 piriform rim 的 floor 或是就是 maxilla 的 midline 那个比较翘高起来的那 crest 的泵，我们还是要有足够的 shaving， 尤其是你的 for one 需要做 intrusion 的时候、啊、那 intrusion 呢，是不是就是说我们从上次那个 redo 那个 case， 他是觉得他开完之后，他当初的术式是一个 counter clockwise rotation， 然后他开完之后，他就觉得他第一次术后觉得他鼻子就塌掉。那我实在也不太，我们也不太懂是什么原因。不过那时候我们就在比较靠 ANS 在前面的底部的 midline， 就是 maxillary crest 的时候，我们有补一个高度的泵嘛，补一个大概两三 mm 的泵。那因为我想可以请主委再稍微说，就是说这个那如果这样子是会好一点，那是不是我们对，其实我们还是有一些是 show face maxilla 需要比较大量的 extrusion 嘛，要往下，假设甚至往下3-5 mm 嘛，那这种情况是不是会稍微会建议是在 ANS 那边要比较稍微还是想办法找一个泵，然后我们那时候弄一个宽度是大概2 mm-3 mm 的宽，也不能太厚嘛，然后你要模拟那个 volume， 然后高度可能就是看你 extrude 多少，你就放一个足够的高度在那个底部那边。我不知道主委对这个的看法是怎么样。
对对对，这个事实上我 routine 的也都这样讲，如果是 intrusion 的话一定要磨泵， extrusion 你的 nasal septum 跟你的泵你的 nasal spine 的 space 超过两 mm 的话，事实上你的 nasal tip 会 drop， 也就鼻子会变小，所以两 mm 以上你理论上都要放一个 cartridge graft 或 bone graft 把 support。 我想这是对鼻子来讲，大概肖院长可能会有很多可以来给我们一点意见。你一个 support anterior nasal 那个 ala 的 support 都是在 nasal spine 附近，如果那地方没有泵，它一定是 scar 的话 contraction， 那时候 tip 一定 drop， 所以会鼻子变塌的原因，那个 case 原因就是因为它 counterclockwise 压上去，你现在弄下来它会拉下来，这个 space 你一定要放一个东西撑进去。 bone graft 可以从任何地方拿的，当然我们可以拿的是 coronary process 或是拿在嘴巴任何地方，对我们来讲都可以，今天把它固定好，给它的 A 啦的 base 的地方或 septum 地方，有的地方撑起来刚刚好撑到就好，撑得太厉害太多了它就 nasal deviation， 太少了它就 nasal dripping， 所以记得这个原则。那 spacing 超过两 mm 以上，你都要想办法用个东西把它弄起来，要不然的话你的 extrusion 以后那个地方一定鼻子会塌下来，这个大家要记得这个原则。 这个也是一样的，如果有这 case， 事实上可以 收集一下，可以来做一个 technical 的一个 review， 对我们来讲大概都有进步，而且对 literature 也有帮助。
好，那请问大家如果没有问题的话，那我们 morning meeting 就到这里，那就是下礼拜再见，谢谢大家。
我没有关静音。
啊。哦，书。